There was a reason that was there. Okay, we'll go ahead and call this meeting to order.
There you go.
Okay, all right, Todd, at least I've got that approval there from you. Is there a motion to go into close?
No, you gotta read it.
Yes. Be it resolved, the Board of Supervisors hereby enters into the closed meeting for the purposes of discussing the following. Discussion concerning a prospective business or industry or the expansion of an existing business or industry where no previous announcement has been made of the business or industry's interest in locating or expanding its facilities in the community. One, project number 2016015. Two, project number 2016030. In addition, discussion or consideration of the acquisition of real property for public purpose or the disposition of publicly held real property where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position or negotiating strategy of a public body. One, acquisition of property, economic development. Two, former Blacksburg High School property. Three, former AEP property. In addition, discussion, consideration, or interviews of prospective candidates for employment, assignment, appointment, promotion, performance, demotion, salaries, disciplinary, or resignation of specific officers, appointees, employees of any public body. One, the Agency of Aging. Two, Juvenile Detention Commission. Three, Parks and Recreation Commission. Four, the Planning Commission. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you, any discussion? Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Five ayes.
We're in closed meeting. Is there a motion to come out of closed session?
So moved.
Is there a second? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Five ayes.
Whereas the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County has convened a closed meeting, and on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas under Section 2.2-3711 of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by the Board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County of Virginia hereby certifies that to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification resolution applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion conveying that closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered by the Board. And what this certification is our word to you that we're only talking about what we're supposed to be talking about in closed session. Is there a motion regarding certification?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins? Ms.
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
At this point in time, I'll ask us to observe a moment of silence, and then we'll ask the county administrator to lead us in the pledge.
Let us pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much.
The next item on our agenda is a presentation by David Clark, resident engineer with VDOT.
It's cold in here.
David, come on down.
Good evening.
Good evening.
A couple of fairly large type projects we've been working on, mostly still maintenance oriented, but still taking us a lot of work and a lot of time to do. We did some night work. I mean, we were traveling Route 8 to the southernmost part of the county. There's some pipe that had to be replaced right there before you get to the bridge over Bull River, and that was several nights' work and some patching all in through there as well on Route 8. over this parking lot closer to Reiner as well. We also were able to get the paver out and finally complete the pretty much rebuilding of Mount Pleasant Road, where we had done some, we'd finished a rural rustic road, paving, surface treating a gravel road, and just in time for the flood last year to take that out, and pretty much had to put that back with asphalt, which now should hold a little bit better, and that is a flood-prone area, and we kind of learned our lesson on that one, as well as paving a really deteriorated section of Old Roanoke Road. And I'm sorry Mr. Creed's not here tonight because he asked for that. Specifically, it was already in our plan, but I can tell him that we did get that done. We've got Meadow Creek Road Bridge still under construction. They should be another couple weeks on that. We've got another one coming up later in the year on Huckleberry Lane, so gravel road off of High Top Road. It dead ends, but it sort of parallels the Huckleberry Trail right there. There are two very large pipes in there that have to be replaced. We're working on the through truck restrictions on Mount Tabor Road. That one is going to require some coordination with Roanoke County, and we're in the middle of getting some dates set up so that either the county administrator, maybe a couple of the board members, can meet with some of the board members in Roanoke County, because it will probably require a public hearing on their part as well. We're getting ready to do, this was a project add to the six-year plan this past spring, but it's such a small, short project. I think we can squeeze it in here before the construction season ends, and that's Strawberry Circle off of Allegheny Springs Road. And then the other thing, we also were able to work on Crab Creek Road to the tunnel. We did a lot of work in there. It's really the tunnels, the railroads, they allow us to pass underneath that tunnel, and they also allow a creek to pass under the tunnel. At the same point, it makes for a very difficult road maintenance at any time of year. Winter, it's all icy. In the summer, it's potholed, and we've had as much rain as we had earlier this summer. It was in pretty rough shape. Our guys went through. In fact, we got a couple of emails from citizens out there saying, thank you for that. Hope it lasts a little while. And then the other thing we're getting ready to work on was the county's rural addition project. Rural addition is when you can set aside some money in your secondary six-year plan to bring in a road that is not currently a state-maintained road. And we've been working on Big Bang Road in the McCoy area for many years, trying to get all the property owners to agree, because we need a certain amount of right-of-way dedicated. And the county staff's been working on that with our people, and we're going to do a slight sort of site distance improvement project right there at where Big Bang comes into McCoy Road. Obviously, that'll benefit people on Big Bang, because we can put that in as a rural addition, but it'll also benefit anybody driving down McCoy Road, because whether that's a state road or not, there are people coming in and out of there, and it can be a tough spot if you can't see coming around that curve. So that should start here pretty soon. Those are our major updates, other than, you know, we just our regular brush cutting. We've done a lot of brush cutting on Pilot Road, a lot of other patchwork, and of course, we're trying to keep up with the grading on the unpaved roads. But other than that, I'll take any questions for you.
Start off with Supervisor Shepherd.
I don't really have any questions. Just thank you for all the work you've done. I know I've put in requests, and I don't know where they go or what, but I drive a school bus, and of course, every route I've ever driven, there's always brush over the road. So I appreciate you doing that. There's still a long way to go.
Right, it's a never ending.
I don't want to harp on you today.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Supervisor DeMotz?
I don't have any questions for you. Thank you.
Supervisor Biggs?
I just sort of wanted to go back to the timeline for the Mount Tabor Road resolution, like you're trying to set up dates now, and I heard you say like you were going to get board members from Roanoke County and mm-hmm. from Montgomery County together, and
yes.
Then what would happen?
Just sort of, I think, agree on a concept, and then hopefully hold a public hearing. We will use the minimum amount of time that's required for advertisement. Mm-hmm. but it has to be advertised in the newspaper and has to be posted at the courthouse. And so I would be, hope that we could have the public hearing probably sometime in October.
Oh, okay, so this is something that's
yes.
coming
yeah,
along looking, fairly fast.
Trying,
okay.
trying to get it on the schedule, of course, is always tough, but we were looking at, I don't think this week is going to work, but I think next week, I think we have some dates open that the Roanoke County board members can attend.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Supervisor Perkins.
Yes, I do have something. It involves Nellie's Cave Road, mm-hmm. and you're probably aware of it, along with Woodland Hills Drive, but Mrs. Sal called, and we had a lengthy discussion about a gravel truck that yes. took out about her trees and a lot of other things, but I think that she and other people that live with her coming up out of Nellie's Cave there, because she's right at the end of the T, she said that they were interested in having a tonnage limit if possible, and that they would also like to reduce the 45 mile an hour sign that just went up at the beginning of Nellie's Cave and then at the very end of it as it hits Woodland Hills. And apparently this truck, you know, overturned and it was pretty serious. I noticed today that she has a brick thing that marks her driveway and that's still kind of this way. And there's a lot of damage done to her property. But I think she was mostly concerned about the safety. And she said this is not the first time that there had been some incidences with the trucks, and particularly this one gravel truck, which was from Roanoke, I believe, Roanoke, Salem, somewhere around there. I don't know if any of you have heard about it, Craig. I don't, Mr. Meadows, I don't know if anybody, she's called here or anything, but no, she no. has talked with Chris.
Yeah, I got a call from another resident, I believe it was on
yeah.
Ms.
Snyder.
There was that accident
yeah.
was on
George
Friday.
Georgianne Falkenham Snyder. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, she was on the Transportation Safety Commission for yeah. 7 years. She's not on there anymore, but she called me about that. And apparently, yeah. I don't know that there's speed limit signs at all right now at Woodland Hills, but I was going to check on that for her.
I didn't see any yeah. on Woodland Hills, but yeah. it was they're on Nellie's Cave. Right. As you first turn on up at Woodland Hills, I was out there today looking to see what was there, and then as you come out of the 25-mile zone where the individuals live, they're very close
right.
at the beginning.
Okay.
So anyway, I would hope that you all would be able to look into that, and maybe if you want to tell us a little bit more about the process, but and because I told her we were looking at tonnage maybe
yeah.
As far as Mount Tabor was,
right.
and she wanted to know what she had to do from this point on to get the ball rolling, so
okay.
to speak.
I'll take a look and see. I meet with the guys on Mount Tabor Road. I'll ask about that one as well.
Yes, and I don't know about another way to get there. I assume that they can go down. I don't guess they want to come down the Ellet Valley Road from Blacksburg or from wherever they are, but she is very concerned with people who go to their mailboxes and things like that, and some of them are elderly and some of them are not, but it's still a safety issue as
right.
far as she's concerned.
And there may be a couple other things that we can do in the meantime.
Okay.
Signs and,
yeah.
We'll look at a couple of things.
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Supervisor King.
Is on Fairview Church, the low water bridge, is it still on the agenda?
Yes, it is. Yeah, we're doing design on that right now, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
So we put that on a 6-year plan, so now we have money, funds for preliminary engineering, and we're working to get that replaced.
All right.
So you guys will get in touch with Ms. Help too, right?
Yes, I can.
Thank you. Excuse me.
No, you're good. And on the big freeway, you just got finished out there in Ryder. Have you doing the study on the speed study?
They're going to look at that whole thing as a safety type of survey. Sometimes they'll do speed, but they'll look at other things too.
All right, because I got several calls this week about since you finished up all the people speeding through her and passing everybody. Yeah. And how long would you think it'd be before you could do a study?
It just depends on their workload. You know, we have a group down in Salem that looks at all that stuff, but they cover 12 counties, so it depends on what their backlog is right now. I would think they could be able to get something into the next month, though. Okay. But they took them a long time to do Nellie Cape Road, the original speed study. That was almost 6 months. So okay. It's just hard to tell.
All right, thank you.
I'll keep you updated.
All right, appreciate it.
I have one issue. I received an email from Mr. Snecker at 1025 Janelle Road, and saying that he was having the culvert leading into his driveway off the road had filled up, and he was concerned that he wouldn't be able to get the oil truck in there, and so he wanted to see if VDOT could come take a look. It's just, I guess, filled up with the rain.
Okay.
And the like. And
that's
so,
on Janelle Road, then, right?
Yes, Janelle Road. 1025 Janelle Road.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Does that spur any other questions?
No, we were just wondering what that noise in the background was. Yeah.
It's not me. Thank you.
Okay. Now, let's get to our agenda. Sorry about that. Lost my place. All right.
Public hearing.
Yes. Public hearing. In regards to a public hearing that's been advertised in the Roanoke Times on August the 28th and September the 4th, 2016, an ordinance amending Chapter 7 entitled Offensive Miscellaneous Article 3, Nuisances Generally of the Code of the County of Montgomery County, amending Section 7-55 to designate mosquito breeding places as a nuisance requiring abatement. Is there anyone here? I don't have anyone signed up in regards to this ordinance, but is anyone here who would like to address the body on this issue? Seeing no one coming forward, we'll go ahead and close this public hearing. Next on our agenda is public address. We don't have anyone signed up, but is there individuals who would like to come and address the board on any subject? I see some hands. If you would just go ahead and start coming forward, you'll have 5 minutes. I would ask that you state your name and address. And as I said before, this is our turn to listen to you. We don't necessarily respond at this point in time because you have to listen to what we have to say. This is our turn where we have to listen to what you have to say.
My name is Bill Turner. I live at 1690 Ellett Road in Christiansburg. Mine is related somewhat to this ordinance, but what I'm basically addressing is we had a very, very terrible fiasco take place in South Carolina. I don't know if anyone on the board has heard of it, but due to a knee-jerk reaction, South Carolina officials in one county decided they wanted to spray for mosquitoes. Well, they killed every bee in sight, and not just honeybees, but all pollinators are very susceptible to this insecticide that they use. And I just ask that when this issue does come to the county, that we kind of take a real careful look at what's going on before anything like that is doing. The bees are already in serious jeopardy. And it doesn't take much with the mites and the parasites that are already diluting the bees to a great extent. We need to try to do everything we can to prevent their death. I just ask that you please pay very close attention to what anybody wants to do, whether it be federal, state, or local. Thank you.
Thank you. Ma'am, I saw your hand up. Would you please come forward? You've got 5 minutes. And please state your name and address.
Linda Majors, 2620 Mount Tabor Road. I did not know about the disaster, but I, second whatever he says. This is a grave concern. I'm here to speak about the resolution that I was here to speak about for the Mont Belly Pipeline. Spoke about it 2 weeks ago. Wanted you to revisit it and look at it. I was told by Dinah Richardson that the chair, the attorney, and the administrator did and thought that nothing more needed to be done. I disagree with that, and these are the reasons why. First of all, you did that in 2014, and it was in the pre-filing stage. So that's totally out the window now. It's like you never did a resolution at all. You need to do it under CP 16-10-000. So that's a really big point. The second huge point is that our group on Mount Tabor Road talked to Carolyn Elephant, and in that conversation, Robert Jones, my neighbor, had done an awesome write-up environmentally on the Mount Tabor Road environmental features. And she had seen it, and she said, "You're going to get that in before the DEIS, right?" And he said, "Yes, right." And she said, "Yeah, you need to do that, because otherwise, if you don't get it in before then, you won't be able to make any claim on anything." So that tells me that if you don't get this in before they publish the DEIS, it's like you never had a resolution opposing this at all. Those are really important points. So if you're going to do anything, it needs to be ASAP. We don't know when this DEIS is going to come out. Sometime in September. We're already, what, at the 12th? Now, specifically to the resolution that you did have, I sent an email to Mary Biggs, to April DeMont, to Annette Perkins, and some other people, but not anybody else on the board or the administrator. That can be remedied. But specifically, Mary wanted to know, what specifically do you have a problem with? Okay, so I'm going to quickly go through that. The first one is on page one, the second whereas, we're no longer in pre-filing. The third whereas, route is incorrect. Because at the time you did this, the route was going to be going through Preston Forest. Things have changed considerably. I hope that you've kept up with this. But it's not going through Preston Forest anymore. It's going just to the other side. It's alternate 200 at this point in time is their preferred route, with Mount Tabor variation, a variation possibly on that. Okay? So you need to be up to date on the route and what you're talking about. The fourth whereas on the first page is it's not going through any subdivisions at all. It's not going through Preston Forest. It's going on the side of it. Now, that doesn't mean that they're not in the blast zone and they'll be incinerated. Some of them will be, and some will have to be evacuated. Most of them will be. It depends on the wind and the fire and the dryness, right? So everybody could be in trouble here, way beyond Preston Forest. Brush Mountain States is further on beyond Preston Forest, so you know they're going to be less involved than Preston Forest. But certainly Countryside Acres, people on Bishop Road, Mount Tabor Road, we exist too. We are citizens also, and I'd like you to recognize that. Page two, the first whereas. You're talking about Preston Forest residents again, and that's what I just talked about, incineration zone, etc. The fifth whereas on page two, Ag and Forest Districts, you have not updated those. At this, I think we have somebody else that's going to directly speak on that, that's very knowledgeable about this. But the AFD-9, Elliston, Peddler Hills, may or may not be affected at this point in time. But the AFD-10 on Mount Tabor Road certainly is, right through the heart of it. Page three, first whereas, delete it. It says, if Mountain Valley Pipeline were to reroute the proposed gas pipeline away from the residential communities to areas that are unpopulated, not containing residents, the Board of Supervisors may reconsider opposing the construction of the pipeline. Now that doesn't say to me that you have opposed the pipeline in Montgomery County. You know, that needs to be eliminated. And therefore, be it resolved, delete that. You know, you've got to get the docket right. You've got to get something done. For heaven's sakes, anything is better than nothing. But for God's sakes, don't, you know, consider the citizens that are not in Preston Forest or Brush Mountain States as non-essential. Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the board? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Torsten Sponenberg, and I live at 2620 Bishop Road. I just am following up a bit on the remarks of the previous speaker regarding the current the current routing of Mountain Valley Pipeline. And I bring this map here. I know it's difficult for you to see. It's a small map right now, but it was prepared by the Montgomery County Planning Commission in January of 2016. And so it is well past the October 23rd, 15 filing date for the Montgomery County, for the Mountain Valley Pipeline. And it shows the so-called proposed route. So it also shows in yellow parcels that are ag and forest districts. In dark green, it shows parcels that are conservation easements. And in the pale, sort of pale chartreuse green, it shows parcels that are both AFDs and conservation easements. So that is the current proposed route as of the October filing. This large map, forgive me, it is large and somewhat unmanageable by one person. Again, this is map has been prepared by the Planning Commission, and it is of April 21st, 2015. It does not have any pipeline route on it. It's just ag. It's just ag and forest districts. So you will see a color, dark gold, right here, right up here. And many of the parcels that are there in dark gold are now on the so-called Mount Tabor variation. So I just want you to be aware of that, that with the Mount Tabor variation route that is being investigated, those parcels will all be affected. Please, I just urge you to follow the advice of the previous speaker and prepare a new resolution under the filing number of CP 16-10. Submit it as soon as you can, because we expect the draft environmental impact statement to be promulgated in September. And as we all know, we're very close to the middle of September. If you get it in before the draft environmental impact statement is promulgated, then it will be as a formal record with the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and it will be a formal filing, comment, remark that they must consider. So thank you for your attention. If you need to look at these maps, I can make them available to you later this evening or at any time. Please let me know. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Is there any other speakers that would like to address this or any other issue? Yes, ma'am, would you please come forward? If there's other speakers, if you could come forward and just have a seat in the front row if there's anyone else who would like to speak. Please state your name and address, and you have 5 minutes.
Diana Richardson, 1431 Breckenridge Drive, Blacksburg, Virginia. I would like to reiterate and support what the previous two speakers have said. And I'd also like to apologize to the board for bringing this to you at a late date. It's just one of those things that I think we had not looked at for a while, but we do see some concerns in the previous resolution. I think especially two things, I'm not going to reiterate what Linda said, but a couple of things. Frankly, I'm not even sure that we need to mention neighborhoods like Brush Mountain or Preston Forest. I live in Preston Forest. I will still be affected by it because of where my house is situated. Not as much as I would have been before if it was planned to come down my street a couple of houses from me. However, I am still in the blast zone. But the point is that, you know, we have talked to you a lot of times, and I think we were in accord about not wanting this pipeline in the county. At least that's what our thoughts were. And I'm not sure it makes it perfectly clear in the resolution as it is written now. And I know that there is not a lot of time to make changes, but I hope that you will look at it again, and I hope the whole board will have a chance to see it too. And I'd like to offer any assistance that Preserve Montgomery County can give you. We have done a lot of research. As a matter of fact, I don't think Mr. Meadows has had a chance to read it. We talked Thursday about information, a lot of research that we've done, and I did send him today to share with the board a listing of a lot of research that we're hoping the attorney, Carolyn Elfont, might look at to see what she might want to have knowledge about. In that same vein, after the board has looked at it, if I may be so bold as to suggest, you might even want Ms. Elfont to just check over it. I don't know what the cost of that is or be prohibitive or anything, but I think she is regarded as one of the most knowledgeable lawyers in the country about these issues, these pipeline issues, and I think it might be good. It seems to me that there's not a lot that needs to be changed, but that this resolution could be kind of zipped up a little bit and could be made just a little clearer. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? I haven't seen any hands, but is there anyone else that would like to address the board on any issue? Seeing no one else coming forward in regards to public address, I'll go ahead and close public address. Craig, I don't believe we have an addendum. Is that
no,
correct?
Sir. No,
is there a motion in regards to consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Is there a motion to go into work session?
So moved.
Second.
And Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Yeah, aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
First up and work session is legislative priorities for 2017.
And Mr. Chair, under tab C of your agenda packet, we have a draft that basically shows the legislative priorities that the board had shared last year. There's one on the second page regarding optical scan voting machines that is no longer relevant, so that one was removed. We then have three that are at the end regarding certification language in regards to constitutional officers for salaries, a request to support salary increases for state court employees in the general district and juvenile and domestic relations court, and one that clarifies constitutional officers and regional jail authorities may obtain liability coverage from providers other than the Division of Risk Management without being obligated to pay premiums. Those were additions that were brought forth by various folks that they asked to be placed on our legislative agenda. As I said, the other ones are basically carryovers from last year, and we wanted to give you the opportunity to review those and share your thoughts this evening. And we will prepare, based on what we hear this evening, we'll prepare a final resolution for your consideration at the September 26th meeting.
I'll start off with Supervisor King.
I have no problem with any of them except for the one, as I always do.
What's that?
Levy tax on cigarettes. I don't believe we ought to just pick on one group.
Levy tax on what?
Cigarettes.
Oh, sorry, I just didn't hear you.
I just don't think we need to pick on one group of people.
understand. Supervisor Perkins?
No, I did read through them. I think that the three that were added are very interesting, to say the least, because I don't think we discussed those, did we?
As I mentioned, those were requested by other folks for the board to consider.
Okay.
So it's really up to the board as to whether you want to include those right. or not.
I think we did agree that we would make this a legislative priority for the Juvenile and Domestic Relations Court right. and General District Court. Yeah. So I think that one yeah. may have that came one's, from us.
Well, that one, I well, we on. Went to yes. visit them, as a matter of fact, and we had some of the employees to come here and talk to us. So I have no problems with that. The other ones, I want to be sure what is the motivation for putting those there and what that intends to, convey to the legislators. So I was thinking just talking about it when we get to that point.
Are you talking about the last three?
The last three reds. I have no problem with the one about the Juvenile and Domestic Relation Court, but I do have, I do want a little more understanding of how the other two got there on this particular point. I don't care who, not the name of the person who right. put them there, but just some understanding of what the person was really driving for or going for.
I can share a little bit on that first one. The first one relates to a recent action. It's a moot point now because the governor's budget, because of the shortfall, they didn't fund some of the things they had proposed. But it related to providing funding for if funding was provided for pay increases for constitutional officers, it required that funding be passed on to the constitutional officer, irregardless of whether the locality was already supplementing their pay or not. So in other words, if the state passed a 2% pay increase for constitutional officers, as we've talked before, we provide a supplement. Now the board has frozen that supplement, but we still pay in excess of the comp board salary for those officers.
Right.
You did reduce the one for the circuit court clerk.
Right.
But what the state has been saying in their budget was that irregardless of what you're paying above the comp board salary, if the state budget passes a 2% increase for constitutional officers, the locality has to certify that 2% gets passed on to the constitutional officer, irregardless of what you're already paying the constitutional officer.
Okay.
And that was a concern. Did that one come from VACO or did that one come from?
It may have. It's a discussion across the state, as well as the fact that there's been discussion the way the language is written that
it's very, yeah.
If you're already giving them a percentage raise, or if your employees don't get any percentage raise, you'd have to give them a raise anyway, even though you're paying way more than the compensation board authorized. So there's so much lack of clarity in what the meaning was or how it needed to be administered. I think statewide there's a request to have that language struck.
Okay. Well, thank you. That helps a little bit. No, I mean a lot, but it helps me to see where they're coming from. Thanks.
That helped me because I was looking at this and saying, I thought we got out of the business of constitutional officers and we all voted 7-0 to end that. But I understand that because we pay, our deputies a lot more than what is required so they can have a living wage. That some years the state may say we want you to give a 2% raise, but financially we can't afford to do that, and they're already making more than they would be if they got a 2% raise.
But we have to do it
according to this.
And Carol made a good point. They're there was some real concern when the governor's budget was passed that the language was very ambiguous, and there was a question about do we or don't we, and as I said, it became a moot point with the funding shortfall. But this was an effort to make sure that that's clarified in the future, that the language is clear. The third bullet point about, and I believe this one came from the regional jail, there's some requirement that constitutional officers and regional jail authorities have to obtain their liability coverage from the State Division of Risk Management. And I believe they want to be, they want to have the flexibility to look at other resources. The way the law, I think, is currently written is even if they go somewhere else, they're still required to pay. Do you remember that one? Is that one?
I don't, but that sounds very familiar.
That one came up as well, and we can certainly research that. That was, as I said, that was requested from another party to be added to the board's legislative priorities, but that's the board's call whether you, and I will tell you on that one, I'm sure that the agencies and the groups that represent the regional jails and the constitutional officers have it on their legislative priorities as well.
Okay, so they just don't want to be told.
They don't want to be told that they have to, right. They want to have some flexibility.
Okay.
And as I said, the rest of these have been on the list, some of them since I've been here.
I know the, and probably Ms. Biggs knows a lot more about this than I do, but I know that the unfunded mandates and the whole idea of more money for localities and the taxing business too. So I know that, you know, what I was sort of thinking is why has the business of giving the teachers and others in the county, you know, the 2% raise, like the governor says, when it may have to not be enough money to do that kind of thing.
They kind of said they would go give them a 2% raise, and then they said, by the way, and everybody signed the contracts.
Yeah.
Considering giving them a 2% raise, and then they said, oh, by the way, the money's not there.
Yeah, right. That's what I'm...
And so, I mean...
Well, this thing sort of makes it imperative that the other individuals get their 2% raise regardless, but not for some other people that are very important for the county.
I think they're included in that as well. The locally supported...
Okay, is that what they're saying?
I believe the intent was in including them.
Okay, thank you, because I wondered why it was not specified, you know, there, except that I know came out that we're, what, several billion dollars away from having enough money?
Billion and a half, yes, ma'am.
Supervisor Biggs?
So if we wanted to make any changes to this or anything, what you're saying is we need to have this, you know, done by the next board meeting. Is that what you're thinking? Because I want to go back and recheck the VACO information on education, because, like, I know these aren't in a priority order, but since the greatest amount of our budget is spent on education, I would think that that should be moved up some way. And I realize that, you know, it's like talking to the wall over there about the taxing authority, but I think that it's really critical that we keep saying it over and over to our people that, you know, the more they demand for us to pay for, because they're not going to pay for it, we need to have other ways to pay for things. And they don't care to hear that. We say it every year. I'll say it again, I'm on my soapbox, but education is the most fundamental thing you can do to invest in your future. And I think that maybe I would like to see that sort of moved up, if, you know, in the priority order, but also I want to check it against the VACO statement for education.
VACO has
Would you have a problem with providing that to Craig before?
Yeah,
our next
meeting? Will send it to everybody, because I want you guys to see if you think we need to add anything or just leave it the way it is, because you don't want to add too much, because when you go to Richmond, you know, and they just, you know, Oh, yeah, we know what you want. But, you know, it would be good to...
Well, are we going to have the representatives invited to...
We typically do that in December. But one of the reasons that we move this up is some of the legislators have said, if you don't get it to us in September, especially one of the things I'm going to speak about is adding the PSA bill to be able to provide internet, add to our legislative. If we don't have that in advance, then they can't run it and buy and say, what do you think about this, you know, delegate from Fairfax? What do you think about this? And so if they're getting it in December, they're saying that's not enough time.
Right. I think December's late, too, because they have to put in their...
Yeah, they have to put the bills in.
Yeah.
So that's why I tried to move it up. But we can still have our legislative dinner in December.
Right. Well, we can say they've got what we... We won't give it to them.
It's brand new,
called December.
It's not anything they haven't seen before.
No,
except for maybe what Chris is talking about. They know.
I know, but still, they may know, and they've seen it for a very long time. We just keep on keeping on. That's the way it goes.
Supervisor DeMonts?
The only questions that I had were actually answered with Supervisor Perkins' questions on the final three. And I'm excited to see that we're supporting salary increases for state court employees with our legislative priorities, because I thought that was very important. So I didn't have any questions about anything.
Supervisor Shepherd.
I have a question about the mandatory water and sewer connections, as in, is that...
What you...
If it's a new line going in, or if it's just a new house going in where the line already is.
I was going to ask to revisit that as well. There have been, our previous board looked at the PSA voted, and a close vote, voted to abolish itself, but we needed to get the authority. If we abolish it and make it a department, right now, if Chris Tuck wants to set up a subdivision, we can require you to hook up to the PSA and not do a private water source.
Through the PSA.
PSA. But Montgomery County does not have that authority. So if we were to make the PSA a department, we cannot make someone hook up. And I'm looking at Marty and making sure I'm getting this right. We could not make Chris Tuck hook up into the water. To the county. And
with rezoning, you could.
Yes, with rezoning. But as long as it was zoned residential, we couldn't do anything to them. They could to do that. So that is the provision, and that was to bring the department, the PSA, into a department underneath the Board of Supervisors. I don't know where we're at on the board as far as where we're looking. That's a direction we still want to go in. I know the last time we went down to Richmond, the Well Drilling Association was very much opposed to this. And their lobbyists were very active. And I don't think the bill made it out of committee. So I don't know whether, and if we have a lot of things on our list, we might get diluted. And so maybe we'll consider whether we want to continue to go forward with this aspect of trying to bring the PSA under a department.
I guess my question didn't really pertain to what I hear you say is nothing's really changing. It's just an act so that it can be done.
Yeah, basically the PSA has that authority. That PSA has that mandatory connection authority now. As the chair said, when the PSA voted, a couple of years ago to abolish themselves, if the county could assume that responsibility. Well, the only way we can assume it is through legislation, and that doesn't seem to be...
Because we're a Dillon Rule state, we have to get the state's permission. The PSA has it. We don't make people say, okay, we ran water by your house, you have to sign up. We don't.
That's kind of where I was going. That's the question I wanted to answer.
We don't do that.
Okay.
But we have the authority. We haven't exercised it. And one of the concerns was, if the PSA became a county department, do we want to maintain that authority? And if we do, then it takes an act of the legislature to maintain that. Again, it's not saying we ever would. It's just so you would have that ability.
Didn't we have a big discussion about all this on PSA? I thought we said something about within a certain area that we would ask them to try to make people sign up. Did we not do that?
I don't think we've, at least not the 4 years I've been here, that we've said we are going to make. Yes, if you're going to build a subdivision, yes, we don't want you to have a private water source. We don't want you to be, because if you're going to have that kind of density, if something's our zone four, we don't want four wells, four septic tanks and the like, if you're going to have that kind of density. But we want that authority, but we've never, at least now I've been on PSA and the board, said, Mary Biggs, you will sign up. We ran the sewer by your house. Yes, you already have a well and a sewer, and we're still going to make you pay to hook up.
Yeah.
It was just the transfer of the authority, but not not saying we were ever going to exercise that authority.
Okay. All
right. Does that
Okay.
That makes sense. Makes sense to me. But
but that was one of the. Now you've stolen my thunder. The only thing I've got left is. I would like, if there was consensus, to add, and I talked about the staff preparing what the bill would look like to give the PSA authority to be able to provide internet services to rural areas that were, not receiving those type of services. Is there a consensus to have that?
Yeah. I got a question about, because I haven't had a chance to sit down with Craig and talk about that presentation I attended, but I guess if we're just asking for permission, that's okay, but there might be other ways to go about doing this that we, don't have to actually, do the PSA type thing. If we can find out more information from the county that's already put things in place, but I don't mind asking for the permission because I think that's a good thing to do. But I still want to investigate from that county administrator about how they set everything up in that other county. And
we've actually done some research.
Good.
And I think we could set up a completely total different authority to provide internet service. Mm-hmm. But if you've already got something in place, it seemed like that would consolidate and make sense, especially when we do have a lot of future construction for our water lines that are going to be coming into play. So.
And there might be ways that you can work with what was presented at that meeting and what we're doing with PSA. Right. We might be able to put it together. Okay. So I think it's fine to add it.
Okay, so that was consensus on that?
I'm okay with it, but I think that really is going to take a lot more study of bringing a lot more people and different organizations together before that can ever happen. There are so many different groups that are involved in this in the county, but somehow they don't ever get together to really say how can we support each other.
Right, but there's got to be that first step of getting permission.
Well, no, I know. That's why I said I do. And I think it's a good idea that we all get together. Just to reiterate what Ms. Biggs was asking.
Is there any other items? Does that spur any further discussion? Any other items for a legislative agenda?
So if anyone has anything, Chris, should we just send it out to everybody?
Send Craig and CC everyone.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right, and I'll just double check on that education thing.
And what we'll try to do between now and the next meeting is get a cleaned up draft that we'll circulate, and once we seem to have consensus on that, we'll add it to the agenda for the 26th.
Do we need to have consensus about where they are, since this is not a priority list, but at the same time, I know Ms. Biggs asked to have maybe the education item pushed up closer
I'm happy
to the front.
I'm willing to talk about moving that. It's 70 when you put in debt service, 71% of our budget.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got the education on number two. Maybe you move it to number three. Would that be good?
No, what do we want at number one?
All right, hold on.
The mandates need to be number one.
I say I say education would be the number one thing, and the unfunded mandates, number two, and then from there, look at what you might want to do, because those are the big, like that ending future state funding reductions. I mean, I mean that's just totally ridiculous that, all of a sudden you have to pay a bill that because they don't want to pay it. So that's important to keep that one up there too.
Oh, I think so.
Because it looks like it's just in any unfunded mandates that comes from promising a raise and then not providing the money.
That's exactly what it is.
And so that's a mandate for us. So I think I'm happy to talk about it.
I think that's a big one, unfunded mandates, because they're rough on us.
So, but we can talk about priorities once we have the list and where we want to go. All right. Next on our agenda for work session is revenue sharing.
Revenue sharing for fiscal year 2018. And there's a tab in your agenda under tab D that has an outline of what I believe Ms. Gibson's going to discuss with us.
Good evening. I am going to talk to you a little bit about potential applications for FY18 revenue sharing. It seems a little crazy because we just started FY17, but that deadline is actually next month. So we just wanted to go ahead and have a work session on those potential applications. But before we did, I also wanted to just give you an update on where we are on some of our current revenue sharing projects, because we have a lot of projects going on. Most of you are familiar with the revenue sharing program, but this is something that only localities are able to do. It's governed by the Code of Virginia. And basically, typically what we see is we get a 50-50 match. For every dollar we put in, the state matches us. In the coming years, as they continue to reduce the pot of funds, some of those matches will be reduced, and we will be putting more forward to do a match. At that point, we'll have to reevaluate, but right now, like I said, for every dollar we put in, we get a dollar of state funds, and so it helps our projects get further faster. Some of our recent projects, these are all VDOT administered. We had two projects on Brush Creek Road, and that was started at the pilot roadside. We had two on Blue Springs Road, and we had a recent one that was also just completed out on Yellow Sulphur. We have some that are in various stages of progress. Mount Pleasant, as David Clark mentioned earlier, we had a piece of that just finished, but we have another piece coming along that's in design, and that design work had to be done in Salem. Boner's Run, currently in design, that's being designed here locally in Christiansburg. Brush Creek, the one that we applied for last year and we did receive funds on, that will start at the other side, that design will start this winter also. And then Western Perimeter Road, which was the project that Virginia Tech asked us to partner with them on, we are currently, because we're a pass-through on that project, we are currently reviewing the agreement that we'll use, like we've done on some of the other projects that are county-administered. The first county-administered project is the developer-funded Meadow Creek realignment, and you guys authorized us to move forward on that last year. That design is underway. It is more easily noted as on the hospital side of exit 109. The Tyler Roundabout project, which is on the other side of exit 109. It's also a developer funded project with FY13 dollars. And as I mentioned, we're starting to spend our FY17 dollars. So the state wants us spending those FY13 dollars or they're gonna take them back. So we've done a small amount of survey work and tried to keep the project alive. This is all via funding from the developer, but they're not as far along as the other side, and so we're basically potentially could lose funding on that at any time. Doesn't mean we couldn't reapply, but that project itself is a $5 million project, and the statewide pot of revenue sharing is going to be about $100 million, so we potentially may not receive that, especially at a 50-50 match. And for the past 2 years, there's been an application for the turn lane projects out at Price's Fork, and these are also county administered. Our on-call consultants with WRA are currently doing some preliminary design work that we've been providing feedback on, and have also worked with VDOT on that. We're planning to try to get it a little further along because several different waivers and exceptions are needed based on the historic nature and the limited right-of-way there. So we wanted to make sure what we show the public is something that is doable, and then receive more input before we get up to a first submittal. So that usually comes in three stages, a 50% design, and then something like a 90% design, and then final. So once we're at about 50%, we're gonna set the public meeting. We were going to do it in October, But they've been doing some redesign on a few elements of it, and so it might get pushed back a little bit further. We'll keep you guys updated on that. So, as promised, I've brought forward a few potential FY18 applications. We'll need to have clear direction on these by next month this time, but we just wanted to bring them to your attention so that you could think on them or think of any other projects that staff could get you more information on before the deadline. The first is Price's Fork. So we mentioned that for the last 2 years, we've funded Price's Fork. The project estimate was $2 million when we started. And so for the very first year, the county applied for $500,000, making it a $1 million for the first year. Last year, we came to you and said that we had some overrun on other projects. So we only applied for $150,000 on Price's Fork last year, $350,000 shy of what we were planning to do. And the overrun, VDOT has been working to get that onto this project. However, as I mentioned, we've been doing some of that preliminary work, and we may very well have to move a water line at more than $300,000 than what we had planned on. We're not 100% sure on that, but we just figured if we really want this project moving forward, which it is a very high priority for the county based on the volume and the safety incidents there, what we decided to do was to go ahead and plan for worst case scenario. So if we take the developer funds plus the county funds and this potential overrun, we're recommending applying for another $100,000 on this project, which would bring us to $200,000 and would be able to keep it on schedule as it moved forward. Now, we can receive, our application can be approved, and if we don't need those funds, we never have to stroke a check to VDOT on that. So it would just be a way to keep the project timeline moving forward. There's another project that VDOT brought to me a couple of months ago out off of Union Valley. You can see here, this is closer to the pilot side. Here's the church, and so that brings you forward up to the 400 block there. VDOT has been working on drainage issues in this area for quite some time. They have some large-scale drainage issues that lead to flooding that are beyond what our maintenance folks can do. And so they said, if we really want to fix this, if we want to chase down the drainage, if we want the road to stop flooding out, and it does, they've had issues where they've had phone lines are exposed. There's some elderly folks in the area that weren't able to depend on their phone service because the roads were washing out, utility lines were being exposed, things like that. So VDOT said that they thought this was a good candidate project for revenue sharing. It's just beyond the scope of what maintenance can do, but it's not something that becomes cost prohibitive for us to take a look at to chase down that drainage, put in some new culverts, and make it a little better there. The estimate on this project is $200,000, $210,000. So again, our ask would be for about half of that in order to make this project happen. This would be VDOT administered also. And there have been two recent paving requests. One is this road here, Pike Lane. That's about 0.15, just over a tenth of a mile actually, because the first portion is already paved. And Pine Hollow Road, this is actually the town of Christiansburg boundary line here. So it's paved up to this point, and then this amount's unpaved. Same thing, just over a tenth of a mile. Very small scale projects that would allow for some consistency there for the citizens. Both have, VDOT did some counting related to the number of houses already being served, plus the lots there. So they feel like if you're looking at a cost benefit ratio, it's a very big bang for your buck on both of those being less than around a tenth of a mile, but very cost effective to go in and do paving on those. So the estimate there would be approximately $100,000 for each, which would make our ask $50,000 on those projects. And just to give you a reminder, last year I mentioned we did a partner with Virginia Tech as a pass-through on the first phase of Western Perimeter Road. As I mentioned, the state is looking at funding on these projects differently. And though they asked for, I believe, $5 million, They received 3.3. They will be hoping to partner with us again on any of the unused portion. Localities are allowed to ask for up to $10 million. We typically have averaged around $500,000. So it doesn't impact any of our projects in any way to allow them to partner with us on this. So just to give you some totals of what we just talked about, the Crisis Fork turn lanes around $100,000, the drainage out at Union Valley, and then the small paving projects. That puts us around $300,000 for all four of those projects. The Western Perimeter Road, they're currently in discussion on what they may want to ask for, but they know it cannot exceed any of the county's portion. And they also know that priority-wise, we put our projects at the top of the list. So that's just some basic information for you guys to think about. And if you have any questions, I'm glad to answer them. Or if you have other project ideas, we're glad to entertain them and get them ready for application.
Start off with Supervisor Shepherd.
I don't have anything.
Supervisor DeMotz.
I don't either.
Supervisor Biggs.
Yeah, but good presentation. Very to the point.
Thanks. Supervisor Perkins.
Nothing, but ditto.
Supervisor King.
Virginia Tech, is that on top of what we agreed to last year?
Yes. It's actually a $34 million project, so they're just working it in increments.
But if we needed $10 million, we could, if we came up with $10 million for matching revenue, we could use that, and they wouldn't be able to apply anything, the way the agreement is worked out. But typically, we've never asked for more than $500,000. So the matching funds work out that way, and so every locality's cap, well, are even the larger localities cap at 10 million?
Million.
Okay.
It doesn't cost us anything. It's a favor to Virginia Tech to be able to use our capacity. We're not using it, but the understanding is if we needed to use it, they drop down off the list.
Thank you.
Sure.
These have to be submitted by November 1st.
Salem wants them by the third week in October.
That's right. They want them. That's right.
And the deadline is the end of October.
Okay.
But we try to get them to Salem about a week ahead of time.
So we will, we can have something drafted for the 26th for the board's consideration. I think that would be good. That way, if there's any further discussion, that would still give us the first October meeting to address it.
The 11th would be the last meeting that we'd want to have the board make a decision.
I think putting on the end of September would be a good idea, like I said, if so, in case something does come up. So,
thank you, Emily.
Thank you.
All right. Now, next on our agenda is courthouse handicap accessibility.
Mr. Chair, I know this was brought up as an issue a board meeting or two ago, and several of us had a recollection that we had addressed this one time before, and now that I'm trying to get it to come up on my computer, it won't. But we did find that this question had come up back in 2013. We had passed the concerns along to Thompson and Litton. Tabby, in your packet, for those of you that can see it, I can't, is a letter from Jack Murphy with Thompson and Litton addressing the concerns that were brought up regarding accessibility and...
It's in G.
I have it under
it's
G.
G.
Yeah, that's where I have it.
Well, no wonder I can't get it.
Yeah, that's why you can't get it.
Well, no, I think it's just... No, I'm not having any more luck with G than I was with E. It's a letter outlining the concerns that were brought forward, and bottom line is the bottom line was Mr. Murphy said we're confident that the newly constructed courthouse facility, which has been granted an occupancy permit by the town, is code compliant and meets the intent of the ADA requirements. So the issues that were brought up were identified in the letter, talking about signage for handicap parking and building access, parking lot, ADA access, counters at the service windows. Now I really messed you up.
Oh no, you're fine. That just makes it bigger.
And TDY phone. Yeah. All those were addressed in the letter, so.
And as someone who utilizes the courthouse on a daily basis, in my mind, I hadn't thought of, there is a lower counter in the clerk's office as you go in the door for individuals who would be handicapped. In general, J&D court, there's a lower counter for those who would be handicapped and wheelchair bound or even utilizing a scooter. Same thing general district court. The circuit courtrooms are all accessible. I can't tell you what the ladies' rooms look like, but I can say the gentlemen's restrooms are all handicapped and have handicapped stalls in each and every one of those. The handicapped parking is on the back side of the building. The gentleman is correct. There is no handicapped parking on the parking deck. It is down on the ground level. There is some walking distance from there, but it mm-hmm. is in compliance with, and we got that certificate from the builders back in 2013.
And it is the parking that is ground level, which is sort of to the rear of the building. Once you cross over, it's covered along that side to the front door.
And I don't know if anyone else requested this to be on the agenda tonight, but I requested it to be on the agenda this evening. One thing that I did want to bring up, just anecdotally, in speaking with some employees in the courthouse, they do regularly hear complaints about handicapped parking. I know there were some plans for the property right there. My memory is escaping me on the name of the road.
It's the old bus station.
Yes,
it's
exactly.
The old bus station that was torn down.
And so if maybe at some point we could look at grading that for additional handicap parking that's closer to the entrance, because the complaints that the staff in the courthouse reported to me that they hear are, one, there's not enough handicap parking, and two, it is a very long distance. So if you're somebody yes. with a mobility challenge of some sort, you have to go quite a ways if you're parked all the way behind the building, and if you're walking with an assisted device or something like that, that is quite an impediment to get in the building. So I would like to at some point consider grading that lot for handicap.
There is an easement that is owned by the neighbors of, I think, and Marty can correct me, of 10 feet that goes out, so we've got to be careful not to affect their ingress and egress. Mm-hmm.
That created an issue. The other issue that, candidly, we didn't realize when we tore the building down is you don't really notice that small lot has a grade to it. It's
yes,
got a grade to it,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
the only way we could get it permitted for handicap parking is we would have to grade it out and level it, which would be some expense, but it would add a couple of parking spaces.
I agree with April on the fact that, you know, the walking from the parking lot to the front, I just think it's too far for a lot of people, and I don't know what do they do if somebody really can't make it from the parking lot to the front. Is there any kind of provision? Does anyone go out and help them? I mean, how do you get them into the courthouse? Because, I mean, if you're on crutches, if you have a knee, a hip problem, I mean, to me, it's a long way to walk.
The hardest part I see is someone who will bring their cell phone with them.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're on crutches, they get all the way to the front door, and they're said, okay, you've got your cell phone with you, you've got to take it back. And that happens. Or we have lots of farmers. And when I was growing up, I always carried my pocket knife to cut square bales with. Well, guess what? You cannot bring pocket knife into the courthouse at this point in time. Mm-hmm. And so that means you're walking all the way back. I wouldn't mind taking a look at the cost analysis and trying to figure out if that's something that we want to do to improve it. We did put handicap parking up there initially, and then the town said, no, there's too much of a slope.
Yeah.
There is one handicap spot, and we keep putting up a sign, and it keeps getting run over.
Yeah.
I mean, it is down more than it's up. And it's not because our staff is not trying to put it up.
We put it up, and it gets run over again.
And they've even put one of those that the type of signs that if it shears, you can go back and put another sign in and put a bolt mm-hmm. in it, because it's happened so much. But really, we've got two handicap spots there. And then when there's not a sign up, it's not illegal. If there's no sign, it's not a legal handicapped spot, and under the Virginia code, you've got to have it
painted on the parking spot.
It has to be painted and signed.
You have to have a sign that's at least, I think it's 3 feet high.
Yep. So
why don't we go over to the concrete place and get a parking? Mm-hmm. I mean, seriously, get a parking concrete and put down there and put the sign up.
Can't be messed up.
Hmm. I think that's why we tore that building down was
put to try to get some additional parking.
It was
for handicapped parking.
So, Chris, what does happen though if a person can't make it from the parking lot to the front?
Typically, if they can't make it to the front, then how are they going to ask for help? Either they've got to have brought someone along, and I will say this: if the deputies are aware of an issue, they they really try to work with people. Mm-hmm. If somebody has a wheelchair, obviously they're going to have to go through the wheelchair and they're going to have to be wanded. But they work around that, and they try to be respectful of individuals, but they still have a job to do, and that's to make sure that someone's not bringing something in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
And so they've got to work through those issues, but you can always call the clerk's offices and say that you're handicapped and that you're going to need assistance. But I'm guessing that if you need assistance to be able to get out of your car, you had to have somebody help you get in your car. And so usually there's someone with them that goes forward and says, hey, listen, I've got someone who's handicapped. At least that's my anecdotal observations. Mm-hmm. The other thing is I'd like to talk with the Sheriff's Department. There's so many people who get turned away, and then there's so many kids who are taking the bus over. They do not have a place for their cell phones. They cannot just go back to take it to a car because they've ridden over there. And if we had law enforcement purposes, they have keys. If you put your gun in, you close that up and put it in a box. And to see if that would be a possibility to have 40 or 50 of those boxes, so a handicapped person who does walk all the way over there can put that item into that lockbox. They take a key with them. They don't come back. They don't get their stuff.
The sheriff and I actually had a conversation about that. That's a security issue, and that some people could bring a cell phone, but somebody could bring something else and lock it in that box, and then you've got a threat right in the front of the building.
Right. I guess so. So now we have kids buying their, but they go outside in the planters and they cover dirt over their cell phones. I mean, that's exactly what happens.
It would be a great business venture for somebody in that block of Main Street or Roanoke Street if they wanted to.
And maybe, little sidewalk.
Well, there you go. Check your phone here.
And maybe we look at it'd be messed with it.
I would like to look at costs related to grading the parking lot, just expand handicap parking access by a couple of spaces. Yeah. I think it's well worth it.
I think Todd's idea in the interim of actually putting one of those concrete, and you put one on each side of that sign, so if somebody runs it over, they're going to leave a mark. It's going to hurt. Because right now, you would think that.
Well, they're not doing it on purpose, I would assume.
I don't know. I mean, it's a metal sign that's 3 feet tall.
Well, I don't intend to run into my garage wall either when I pull into it, but sometimes that happens.
I understand. But anyways, it keeps getting taken out. And I can't tell you how many times I've seen the county staff over there putting it back up.
So. Can we look at that and see if we can
I think that's a good idea.
I like that. And that at least gets us one or two spots up there. Mm-hmm. I forgot how many the town approved.
Okay.
And so.
Where are we? Can we have a break?
Yes, absolutely. Let's take, it is approximately 8:30. Let's come back after, say, 15 minutes.
Well, do we need to go out of work session?
Let's go out of work session. And then that's a good idea.
Let's just stay in work session. That'll be great.
We could take a break in work session. Is there a motion to go out of work session?
So moved. Second.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Moss?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Now, let's take a break for about 15 minutes until 8:45.
That sounds good.
There you go.
All right. Next item on our agenda is old business. An ordinance amending the Chapter 8 entitled Planning and Development of the Code of the County of Montgomery. Amending Article 3, Erosion and Sediment Control, Section 8-61 through 8-67, in order to comply with the state law changes concerning local erosion and sediment control programs, and Section 8-69, in order to establish a lump sum fee schedule. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. Demots?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Subject B, an ordinance amending Chapter 10 entitled Zoning of the Code of County of Montgomery, Virginia by amending Sections 10-21, 10-30, 10-31, 10-33, 10-34, 10-35, 10-41, and 10-61 respectively by defining the terms of solar energy systems minor, solar energy systems major, and solar system energies systems accessory use, and by designation solar energy systems minor as permitted use in a A1 agricultural, M1 manufacturing, ML manufacturing light, PIN planned industrial, PUD planned unit development commercial, and PUD residential planned unit development residential districts, and by designating solar energy systems major as permitted by special use permit in A1 agricultural, M1 manufacturing, ML manufacturing light, PIN planned industrial districts, PUD community planned units development commercial, and PUD residential planned unit development residential districts.
Good job.
Did I get it all, Mark? Okay.
I'll second it, but do you think you should read it again just to be clear?
When Marty said, I said, do I have to read all of that? He said, yes, you do. Okay, there was a motion. Was there a second?
I seconded it, yeah.
Okay. Is there any discussion? I would just, I've said this before at several different meetings, this is our planning department staying ahead of the curve. Moving forward, you're seeing more and more of these solar farms, and I'm proud of the work that both the Planning Commission has done on this, as well as our planning department. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. Demots?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
New business. Refund 2011 bonds, a resolution authorizing the issuance of not to exceed $78 million general obligation school refunding bonds of the County of Montgomery, Virginia, to be sold to the Virginia Public School Authority, providing for the form and details thereof, and authorizing the refunding of the county's $86,115,000 general obligation school bond series 2011A. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. Demots?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
And boy, am I glad to see subject B. Resolution establishing the personal property tax relief percentage for 2016, just because it's very short compared to what I've been reading. That being said, is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second? Any discussion?
Only thing I would add, Mr. Chair, is the percentage continues to decrease. This year it was 43.81%. Next year it's projected to be 40.22%.
Anything else? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Demots?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Subject C, resolution approving New River Valley Juvenile Detention Commission service agreement. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I'd just like to commend Carol Edmonds as our representative and former Chair Brown on the Juvenile Detention Commission, and this has been a document that's been a long time coming. Appreciate the work.
Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. Demots?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Subject D, Parks and Rec Master Plan. And is there a motion?
So
motion.
Moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Ms. Demots?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Subject D, commemoration Tom Bain, former Parks and Rec Director. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Moss?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Resolution of recognition of Schaefer Memorial Baptist Church's 150th anniversary. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Right. Any discussion?
Wow, it's hard to believe.
That's right. Well, it's, you know, it's
so much history.
Corresponds to CII, so, mm-hmm. You know, for their 150th, they all came at the will of Colonel Schaefer, General Schaefer, whatever he was.
No further discussion. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Subject G, proclaiming October as 2016 as Crime Prevention Month. Is there a motion?
Motion.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Subject H, proclaiming October 23rd through 31st as Red Ribbon Week.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Six ayes.
County Attorney's Report.
No report.
County Administrator's Report.
In the spirit of the County Attorney's lead, no report this evening.
Wow.
Wow. Wow. That
happened. I think I've been on this board for 4 years. Usually, I've just got a couple of things.
Yeah.
Eight items later.
I usually do have a couple of things, but I decided.
One eternity later.
You know. Several of you said you were still tired from Bristol, so I decided I'd let it go tonight.
Supervisor Biggs.
Okay, just two things. The first is, how do we want to go about addressing the concerns that were brought to us about our 2014 resolution about the pipeline? I think I forwarded to you Ms. Major's email with what she stated tonight. Like, and I guess I'd like to ask Mr. McMahon, how do we go forward with any of this?
If you would like, I can take, you know, her comments and then maybe prepare a new resolution that would, you know, would reference the old one, and then maybe mention some of the changes. But I think we need to be careful, mm-hmm. because nothing's in stone right now. The line has moved out of like Brush Mountain and Preston Forest, but it could always go back, and mm-hmm. so I'd be reluctant to take them out, but we mm-hmm. could, you know, make comments or reflect on where it is now and what our concerns are with that, and then I would recommend just running it by Caroline, just get her thoughts, and then, you know, have something for the next agenda.
Okay, and this this timeline they were talking about for the CP16-10-000, that's not something that's going to happen before we can do all this, right?
Well, if you remember with the pre-file, you can pre-file in FERC, and that's what Mountain Valley did, and the board came out, you know, pretty quickly against it, and then the pre-file turned into a regular filing. It's right, it's a different number, but I'll talk with Caroline. It's
good.
Hard
okay.
to believe that anything that wasn't filed before is not still in mm-hmm. file. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't, if you so choose, to amend the resolution. I'm not a man, but come out with a new one. And a new one referencing the old one. And so we can do that, but I'll run that by her too. But we should have everything done in the next 2 weeks. The next thing is, the big thing that's going to happen next is that the rumor is, or reports are, that the draft environmental impact statement is going to come out probably sometime near the end of this month. Once that comes out, then there'll be a big review process about, I think it's 90 days, where there'll be some public meetings. Probably we asked for one here in Montgomery County, if you remember. And then we'll be able to comment, we will comment on that draft environmental impact statement.
Okay. All right, so, and I was thinking sort of a little bit about this, you know, depending on what, you know, our legal advice is, but it also would give two of our new supervisors a chance to, mm-hmm. you know, have a say since, you know, they weren't here when we originally had the resolution. But I don't want to do anything to mess anything up, I mean, at all, because we definitely are against the pipeline coming in Montgomery County. But I just wanted to know how to handle that situation.
And if you recall, there was some negotiations, and you know, we wanted them to avoid major subdivisions. And that's why we put in that provision about taking it into, if it's going to be built, affecting unpopulated areas, is if it's going to be built, and we passed a resolution opposing it outright. But I would hope that, and you hear rumors about that the other counties are actually negotiating with Mountain Valley Pipeline to avoid certain areas and working with them, and rather than just simply having a position of we oppose you outright to we will work with you to have limit the impacts on our citizens. And I don't know if that's something, we've got two new members, if that's something we want to revisit. And I know that the preserve, the NRV, was very much opposed. They just wanted to simply, you know, oppose it outright. And that was their sentiment. And you know, I ended up voting with the majority just because I wanted us to speak as many as with one voice. But I do have concerns that the impacts in the other counties, because they are negotiating with MVP, their pipeline may have a less impact on their citizens because they were willing to sit down and talk with them about avoiding certain areas.
How do we know they're doing that? What proof do we have?
I can only say that, one, if you remember the conflict that their attorney had, and that's one of the things that they said was, and said to us, was our direct opposition and unwillingness to negotiate is one of the factors why their attorney had a conflict. Then you and you know, you talk with folks and you listen and try to say, all right, what's going on? And but primarily that is one of the biggest factors, is the conflict issue, and then talking with the previous counsel that we tried to solicit, that was one of the issues, is our stance on direct opposition and not willing to negotiate. And I understand where we're at, but if we're going to revisit it, I think we need to look at that impact and whether what's the best way to go. And it may be that we vote and say we oppose it outright and we will not negotiate, and this pipeline needs to be opposed. Or we may look at it a different way and saying, okay, we oppose it, but if you're going to build it, here's where it will affect the least amount of people. And I understand where we don't want to be drawing the lines, because none of us are engineers. None of us have those type of skills. And this, it would be extremely hard for us to be saying, okay, it's going to affect Daryl, but it's not going to affect April. And for the Board of Supervisors with limited resources and no real engineering, or very limited engineering staff and planning for this type of project that is how many billions of dollars? But I think that's one of the factors that at least I will be considering when we look at a new resolution.
Well, I would think that the citizen group, from what I could understand, is they are still opposed to it, period. And I would think if we were to go back and change our stance and say, well, we were sort of opposed to it, but now we sort of like, okay, we sort of will, I think that would, personally, I think that would create a big problem, because I think they believed and they worked with us to keep the faith that, no, we don't want it. And I still feel strongly about that, but I understand your point of wanting to try to do the least harm. But I think that would open a whole can of worms, literally, if we were to change our mind. And I don't think I can go and support that.
Right. And
just to be clear, I'll make sure their comments and their concerns they raised tonight, that I'll share those with Caroline. And
The conservation easements and the like, and the forestry areas that are going to be affected. We already have them.
Filing and then the timing. And I know Caroline's made it clear that you want to get your comments in prior to the impact statement, because then it's incorporating, hopefully, those comments, or at least you're on record prior to them coming out. But, you know, the board has been on record, you know, both because of environment and economics and other reasons. But we'll clarify that.
Okay. Okay, then my second thing, I noticed that we got that request from Dr. Meyer, the superintendent, about switching that $10,000 from the Boys and Girls Club at Shawsville Middle School to, you know, to directly to Shawsville Middle School so they can have their own after-school program. And I was wondering, that was dated August 29th, but I'm sure that there's, I don't know if there's a program that's going on right now, but is that something that we need to act on tonight so that they can fund the program? Because I think it's very important to have after-school programs, especially for middle school, well, elementary too, but middle school, I think there's a real need there. So I wondered if we have any kind of information. Is this something we need to do now to get the money to them, or?
I can't imagine they can absorb $10,000 if it's true.
Because they're just asking, they're not asking for any more money, they're just asking to switch the money from what we originally were going to put in the Boys and Girls Club to the after-school program that Shawsville Middle School will run, correct?
Except that the $10,000 provided to the Boys and Girls Club supported a program at Christiansburg Middle and at Shawsville Middle. What the schools are offering is a completely different program than that, but an after-school program only at Shawsville.
Well, what's going on at Christiansburg Middle?
They're not having the same program, as I'm told.
Are they having an after-school program?
I don't know.
See, I would like to know that. So is this something that we can ask for clarification and put on our next agenda? Okay.
Be happy to do that.
And can we find out, Carol, about the what they're doing? Because it sounds like what you're saying is before they had $10,000, but it was going to two schools. So I'm imagining in my mind it's $5,000 to a school, but now they're asking to put $10,000 at Shawsville. Is that what you're saying?
It was going to the Boys and Girls Club, and they were also providing funding to provide the program at Christiansburg Middle and Shawsville Middle. And then the Boys and Girls Club didn't get funded from another source, from a grant. And so they stepped back and said they couldn't provide it at either school.
Okay. So I guess my question would be, what is going on at Christiansburg Middle School then? And, you know, what, you know, so it sounds like all the money that was once used at both schools going to one. I would like to have more information. But put it on our agenda. Thanks. That's all.
Super. I'll make sure I go back to my agenda and make sure I, is it Supervisor DeMont? Yes, thank you.
Just two things. First, just to touch on the MVP, the resolution that we have, I am definitely in support of advancing resolution edits as quickly as possible to get them in before the DEIS, and to address the concern that you guys were discussing about opposing it or negotiating, I would be in the in favor of opposing it outright as well, primarily for environmental concerns. And then also, on a much more happy, positive note, I have information to share about Sustainability Week in the town of Blacksburg. Sustainability Week is a partnership between the town of Blacksburg, Virginia Tech's Office of Sustainability, and Sustainable Blacksburg. Sustainable Blacksburg is an all-volunteer organization. In my spare time, I'm the president of that organization. So I've been partnering with the town and Virginia Tech to collaborate on 1 week, September 18th through 25th. We have 25 events that week that we are that we're spearheading. There are a couple of events that last all week. There's a children's art project called What Color is Water that will last all week. There's also a Caught Green-Handed campaign. And we also have a character called the Bag Monster to educate citizens on the impact of plastic bags. One household will, on average, if they use plastic bags at the grocery store, go through 500 bags per year. So the Bag Monster is a costume of 500 plastic bags to show what that amount of trash actually looks like. So the Bag Monster will be running all through Blacksburg that week. We also have a ribbon cutting for the 16 Frogs project. That's a project that spotlights Blacksburg's freshwater heritage in the original 16 squares. There'll be small bronze frogs placed at key watershed locations throughout the 16 squares. We also have a shop and dine fundraiser for the Susan Garrison Fund, which is, Susan Garrison was the town's previous sustainability manager. She passed away in 2013. And then just to give a very brief idea of some of the other events we have electric vehicle workshops, solar home tours, community garden tours, food tastings, service projects to include invasive species removal, tree plantings, both on campus and on town, or and in town, and then education on topics from green burial to permaculture and everything in between. I brought some flyers and I'll just put them up here if anybody wants to grab them afterwards. It has some information on the shop and dine fundraiser for the Susan Garrison Fund, as well as a little bit of information on some of the events. And on the back of the flyers, it tells you where to go to get more information. We use small flyers because it is Sustainability Week. So these aren't as comprehensive as everything we have. But I'll leave them up here if anybody wants to get them afterwards. And that's it.
Supervisor Shepherd.
After that, I have nothing.
Supervisor King.
No report.
Supervisor Perkins.
I don't know. I thought that I read in the paper that Miss is it Mason, the commander in chief,
the arsenal,
is going to have a public program at the library in Christiansburg on Wednesday, the 21st, which the public is invited to explain.
I didn't see that, but I'll.
Well, I think that's what I saw. So I just thought maybe we might want to investigate that a little bit and see if it's something that we would like to encourage people to attend. It's open to the public, and she's going to explain what I guess has happened at the Arsenal this year and this past year, and I'm certain that the burning situation will be, you know, there too. And then the Arsenal did have a brief explosion, too, just a few days, weeks ago, I guess it was. So anyway, and other than that, I don't have anything.
I only have one thing, and I don't. And it may be because I'm a criminal defense attorney, but I was very proud of the transparency that our local law enforcement allowed in showing by the traffic stop data. And I don't know if anyone else was looking at that, but it was in line with the stops, with what our racial makeup is here in Montgomery County. And there was no indications of any racial profiling. But in many times with a stop, you don't see who the driver is. An officer is behind that individual. But what was even more impressive to me was the searching of vehicles was within those same areas that our officers on a whole are not conducting racial profiling. But the more important thing is that the law enforcement was willing to be transparent. They were willing to provide the statistics to see if there was a problem. And I think both Christiansburg, town of Blacksburg, and our own sheriff's department needs to be commended for allowing that to take place, and we should all be very proud of that those statistics. So,
Chris, hold on 1 second before you adjourn. I looked this up for you for the meeting.
Thank you.
It's Wednesday, September 14th, so it's this Wednesday.
Okay.
From 6:30 to 8 p.m. at the Christiansburg Library.
Okay, I knew it was a Wednesday night, but I wasn't quite sure
thank
that
you.
Date.
Sorry to,
so
that.
Thank nope. you.
Sorry to jump you like that.
And
I also,
I'm glad you did. Thank you.
There's been several folks that were talking about the Meadow issue, and I've seen several different emails talking about that they will see us on Monday, October the 10th. They will not see us on Monday, October the 10th, because that is Columbus Day, and they will see us on October the 11th.
Tuesday.
So if you could convey that to any of the folks who are interested on that Meadow issue and some of the work session that we're going to have on that issue, it's the former AEP property. Is there any other business? We're adjourned.